Hello dear students, so now we will start another topic, that is the noise in biomedical signal recording. We have studied about the different systems of our body and we have seen different types of signals associated with different types or different systems of our body, mainly ECG signal, EEG signal, EMG signals. So now this is about different kinds of noises, and in coming lectures we will also see what are the different sources of noises in that signal. So let's begin with the noise. Mainly here we will consider the random noise. So before starting with the noise, let's see what we mean by deterministic signal. And then we will go for random signal, and from that we will develop a definition for random noise. Now a signal that may be computed using, we can say, a closed form mathematical function of time, and also that is a predicted knowledge of few past samples of the signal. So we can say the signal which can be computed using some mathematical function, or it can be predicted from a knowledge of few past values of the signal, we can call it as a deterministic signal, or I can say we can represent it in equation form. Now, what is a random signal? A signal that does not meet the condition associated with a deterministic signal means it cannot be formulated as an equation, and it cannot be predicted from the past values of the signal, then we can say, we can consider that signal as a non-deterministic, or it is a random signal. So these signals are generally expected to display more excursions around a reference level within a specified interval than the signals which are predictable, or we can say the signals which are deterministic. Now from this we can say what we mean by random noise. So the interference that arises from a random process, such as we can say thermal noise in the electronic devices, we can call it as a random noise. So it is basically arising through a random process which cannot be predicted. So this random process is mainly characterized by the probability density function, which is abbreviated as PDF, which represents the probabilities of occurrence of all possible values of a random variable. So it is not giving an exact equation, but that will be a probability density function. Means we can represent that random process or random signal by a probability density function. Now, let's consider a random process which is represented as eta, and it has the probability density function as P eta, in bracket it is again eta, and we assume the mean is mu n for that random process eta, and it is given by the first order movement of the probability density function, which is defined as, you can say, expectation, or you can say mean is nothing but integration within the range of minus infinity to plus infinity eta, then probability of that random process with respect, we are integrating with respect to eta, where this e, we can say it is representing the statistical expectation operator. Because it is a random process, we have to deal with statistical properties. So, and it is very common to assume that the mean of a random noise process is zero. So, the mean squared value, which is also abbreviated as MS, value of a random process eta is given by the second order movement of the probability density function. So, first movement will give us the mean, and the second order movement will give us the mean squared value of that random process. Here it is eta. So it is the squared value, or I can say mean squared value, and you can see in the equation 2, so it is eta square. Again, we are integrating with respect to minus infinity to plus infinity in the range and with respect to eta. So these are the two movements. First order movement, which give us the mean, and the second order movement, which give us the mean square value of this random process eta. Now, the variance, which is represented as sigma n square of the random process, is defined as the second central movement. Why we are calling it a central movement? Because we are taking the difference across that mean. So it is expectation eta minus mu n. Mu n is what? Mean, or we can say first order movement square. It is again integrating in the range of minus infinity to plus infinity. So eta minus mu n whole square probability function into d eta. That is, again, we are integrating with respect to eta, so that is variance. And we know the square root of the variance function gives us the standard deviation, which is sigma n for that particular process. So, and we can also say that sigma n square is basically expectation of eta square minus mu n. Mu n is what? Expectation eta square. So one is the square second movement, other is the first movement. And if the mean is 0, then we can say mean of a random process is 0, then it will be sigma n square equal to expectation eta square. So when the values of a random process eta form a time series, means if it depends upon time, basically now we are going to random signal, or it is a function of time, then we have a random signal, or we can say a stochastic process, then we will represent that eta as a function of time. So it is eta, in bracket you are keeping t. So that is now random signal. So from random process we have developed random signal, basically that is a function of time. Now we have to note, so mean represents the DC component, we know that thing. Mean square value represents the average power, and the square root of the mean squared value, normally we call it as root mean square, or the RMS value, it will give the average noise magnitude or level, and these parameters we can use in signal to noise ratio. When we want to calculate the signal to noise ratio, mainly we are going for RMS value. Now, how we can say that this biomedical signal can be a random signal? So, a biomedical signal of interest, that is XT, is observed in an environment with random noise. So, whenever we are doing the experiment and we are getting the signal, actually in that some random noise can be added up. The measured signal, YT, is the realization of another random process. We are calling it as Y. And now, that YT, we can say it is XT, which is the signal of interest, and in that a random noise is added up, that is eta T, we can say random signal. So YT is a combination of XT plus eta T. So each of this random process X and Y, they are characterized by its PDF, that is probability density function. So we can say for random process X, we are saying PXX, and for Y, we are saying PYY respectively. And the two random process, basically X and eta, means the signal of interest and the noise, are said to be statistically independent. Why, how we can say, or when we can say this thing? If their joint probability density function is equal to the product of their individual density functions. Means, you can see equation number 5, that the combined, or we can say joint PDF, is nothing but the product of their individual PDFs, that is PXX, P eta, eta. Now, first order movement and the second order central movement of the signals XT and YT, how they are related? So, expectation, or we can say first order movement of Y, it is mu Y, which is nothing but equal to mu X. Because why it is equal? Because we are considering that the mean of noise is 0. So, we can say by equation number 6 that the expectation of first order movement of the signal of interest, that is X, and the combined signal, which is X plus eta, that is Y. So, expectation for both will be equal. And if I talk about the central movement, second central movement, so that is sigma y square, which is nothing but the square addition of both the second central movement, that is sigma y square will be nothing but sigma x square plus sigma eta square, that is given in equation number 7. So here we know mu represents the mean and sigma square represents the variance. So it can be, if I am taking it Y, that means it is for random process Y. If I am taking X, that is it is for random process X. And if I am taking eta, that means it is for random process eta. And as I mentioned, we have assumed that mu n, that is the mean of noise, random noise process or noise signal, is equal to 0. Now, another point is on how we can measure different properties of this noise signal or random process, we use different parameters. So one such is ensemble averages. Now when the probability density functions of these random process are not known, then how we will calculate the expectation operator? In that, it can be computed using a collection, or we can say ensemble averages. Now suppose we have m observations of the random process X as a function of time. So we can give by equation number 8, that is x1t, x2t up to xmt. That is, we are having m observation of that random process X. And how we can calculate the mean, or we can say the expectation of statistical expectation value, that is, can be estimated at a particular instant of time, let's suppose t1. So how it is estimated? It is limit, let's suppose m approaches to infinity, we have infinite number of observations, so it can be 1 by m because it is anyway mean, and then we have to add all the x values at that particular time instant, let's suppose we are considering for the time t1. So you can see in next slide, which I'll show different signals. So there we will see that vertical lines, you can see in that figure also first. Here we have m number of observations, mainly we are considering 10 observations. So you can see at t1 and t2, we are calculating, means at different time instants, we are calculating this ensemble averaging, or we can say the statistical expectation operator. So in this figure, the two vertical lines, mainly t at t equal to t1 and t equal to t2, that is t1 plus tau, where tau is a delay, so represent the ensemble averaging process at two different instants of time. Fine. Now, next parameter is autocorrelation function, that is ACF. So it is represented as phi auto, because we are considering auto, so it is of the same signal, so we are taking phi xx, because it is between the same signal, we can say, but at two different time instants. So here again we are considering two time instants, one is t1, other is t2, which is nothing but t1 plus tau, that corresponds to a random process X. That's why we have taken phi xx is a time series, and it is given by, you can see by that equation, it is expectation xt1, xt1 plus tau, and it is given as an equation 10. You can see again integration with the range of minus infinity to plus infinity, xt1 plus tau, and then we have the probability density function Pxx with respect to x we are integrating. So that is the autocorrelation function for any random process. If you want, you have to consider that particular segment. And it can be estimated as, you can see, let's suppose if it is a discrete kind of process and we have m number of observations, so it can be again approximated as limit m approaches to infinity 1 by m. Now here it would be summation, because we are mainly considering m number of observations and m is approaching to infinity we are considering. So k equal to 1 to m, again we have how many observations, we are considering m number of observations. So between two different at particularly one observation we will take at two time instants, and we will add all the observations at that particular time instant. So xk t1 into xk t1 plus tau means we are considering two different time instants. Here we know tau is nothing but the delay parameter. So the autocorrelation function indicates how the values of a signal at a particular instant of time are statistically related to values of the same signal at another instant of time. You can see k, small k is same, that means same signal we are considering but at two different instants of time. Now another parameter is time averages. So when we are going for time averages, if our sample observation means of random process is a function of time, that means we can represent it by xkt. Now we have taken t, so it is possible to compute time averages or temporal statistics. How we can do it? We can integrate with respect to time. Previously we have integrated with respect to, you can see, we have integrated with respect to x. Here also you can see we have integrated this thing. You can see we have integrated with respect to, here we have integrated with respect to eta, and further we are integrating with respect to x, and then now if we are considering time average, we are integrating with respect to time, that is t. So it is given as mu, because we are calculating average, so we are again representing it with mu x, because it is for signal x, k at a particular, we are considering a particular observation, so k is a unique value there. So limit t approaches to infinity 1 by t. Now the limits are minus t by 2 to t by 2 and xkt dt. So we are taking one particular observation. Now if, let's suppose we assume the discrete or sampled signal, then we can replace this integration by summation. So now the time average autocorrelation function, that is phi xx, now we are considering tau with k also. So tau k, it is given by limit t approaches to infinity 1 by t. Again the limit is minus t by 2 to plus t by 2 xkt, but now we are taking that x signal at two different time instants. Fine. So because autocorrelation, mainly we are considering for a same signal but at two different time instants. So it is time t and t plus tau. Now, we can say that random noise can be characterized, as we have seen, in terms of ensemble or temporal statistics, depending upon whether it is time dependent or not. It can be represented in terms of autocorrelation function. And further, one more point it is to be noted, the Fourier transform of the autocorrelation function is nothing but the power spectral density, that is PSD. So it is useful in spectral analysis and the filter design. Later we will see in some lectures we will study about spectral analysis. So there we will calculate the power spectral density, which is nothing but the Fourier transform of autocorrelation function. Now next is covariance and cross correlation. When we want to compare the two random process, let's suppose random process X and random process Y, then we have to go for covariance. So it is given, as you can see in the equation. So covariance is CXY, because now we are computing between two different signals or processes XY. So it is expectation x minus mu x, y minus mu y, and double integration. Again, limits are minus infinity to plus infinity. So x minus mu x, y minus mu y. Now we are taking joint PDFs of random process x and y. So next, if I talk about cross correlation or correlation coefficient, so the covariance parameter is normalized to obtain the correlation coefficient. As you can see in this, we have normalized by dividing it with sigma x and sigma y. So for by that we can calculate the correlation coefficient, which is rho. As you can see in equation number 5, it is represented as rho xy, with the range of rho xy will be, because it is normalized, so it will have range of minus 1 to plus 1. And a high covariance indicates that the two processes have similar statistical variability. So if it is covariance is high, it indicates that both the processes, they have similar statistical variability. And we can say, when we can say they are uncorrelated, means both the processes are uncorrelated, if that correlation coefficient is zero, then we will say that the two random processes, here it is x and y, they are said to be uncorrelated. Now another function is there, which is cross correlation function. Now when the random process x and y, both if they are function of time, then we have to calculate cross correlation function. So as you can see, it is given by equation number 16. Again, here we are considering the two signals x and y, both are calculated at two different time instants, and we are using joint probabilities. But here we are considering time t1 and t1 plus tau. And correlation functions are useful in analyzing the nature of variability and spectral bandwidth of the signal, as well as if I want to detect some events by template matching, we can go for correlation, or I can say cross correlation functions. If it is same, then it is autocorrelation function. If it is different, then it is normally called as cross correlation function. So this was all in this lecture, and this is the reference for this topic. So thank you so much.